So, as we start a brand new day, we are introduced to a new character, Professor Oyama. He is an assistant professor of modern social studies at Nanto University, and he has called us into his office for a very specific reason today. Though it does take him a bit of time to get to that reason due to the overwhelming mess of his office, but he wants to talk to us about Odaka. Or more to the point, he wants to talk to us about the circumstances regarding Odaka's death. Though we weren't his first choice to go to. He actually wanted to talk to Riko, but she's disappeared within the last couple of days. But yeah, the police have approached Professor Oyama here to talk to him about Odaka's death and the mysterious circumstances that surrounded his death, which I can completely understand. He did kind of drown in the middle of a room with no water. But the conversation takes a bit of a weird turn here, as we get to learn a little bit more about Professor Oyama and his expertise, I suppose. And that's in the realm of folklore, which, well, in these more modern times is kind of frowned upon, but it's not so much the folklore has disappeared from the world, it's that it has evolved. It has evolved into urban legends. Urban legends, while sometimes a bit far-fetched, kind of are still relatable in modern terms, because they're not like a folklore where it's magical dragons and pixies overtaking and controlling people and things in the real world. Instead, it's stories that could happen, maybe, in some bizarre circumstance. And that's kind of where our situation comes into play. Yeah, we relate the story of this mysterious haunted game to Oyama, and how it could possibly, in the furthest realms of reality, could maybe have some connection to Odaka's death. It's at least coincidental considering what we have been experiencing ourselves, though Oyama yet again kind of goes a bit overboard. He seems to theorize the fact that there can be some danger in the form of text, video, media in general that can affect people's brains, which I can't agree with. There are such things as subliminal messages, psychological things that can affect people's brains, make them do things. But the way Oyama seems to state it is that these forms of media can actually physically affect people. That it can make undue harm come to people. That you can pick up a newspaper and not just get a paper cut, but perhaps drown in your own home. And he seems to readily go along with this idea of a killer curse being transported via a game console, which in the real world would be far-fetched. But that wasn't our TS. It appears Oyama has a TS himself, and he wants to check something on ours. He also has Odaka's TS, and he presents us with something of a, I don't even want to call it a puzzle, it's more trial and error than anything. As he comes back, he is going to tell us that there is some correlation between both Davy and Odaka's TS. But he wants us to figure out the connection ourselves. And we're going to do that by looking at the connection logs for each one of the TSs he presents us. Now, just to save time, I'm going to go ahead and give you the correct answer, which is the mrcy-gen.ts.ip. Now, normally, you would have to go through all three of these, figure it out for yourselves, and restart from the start. But, well, in this case, I just want to get around it. So, yeah. All three of these TSs all have these matching IP addresses. And while we don't initially know what MRCY-gen.tsip is. Quickly enough, Oyama here is going to be able to tell us just where that is. And it's at a hospital. An abandoned hospital. Long abandoned. Abandoned 4 years ago because of illegal practices. And that is a very good question. I have no idea why a game would be broadcast from an abandoned hospital of all places, but he postulates that it might be a good idea if maybe we go investigate the hospital ourselves, especially considering that we might only have 5 days left to live. Though, honestly, Oyama does not approach this from an edge of caring. He sees this more as a guinea pig that could possibly support his bizarre theories. But he is going to allow us some help here. He's going to email us via RTS, but for right now, we're just going to go ahead and head out to Mercy General. Now, before we can explore too much, we do get a familiar vibrating. We haven't heard that since the tutorial area, but it is probably a very important email from Professor Oyama, so let's go ahead and check that out. Or Oyama is just testing to make sure that we are paying attention. And we are. We are going to be checking every email that he sends to us. We can only hope that in the future it is something valid. But now we can start to explore the hospital. It's a little bit larger than what we've had to deal with so far. And it's a little bit more ostentatious than I would expect, with a chandelier of all things. As you could probably assume from a hospital that's been abandoned for 4 years, things are a bit on the dilapidated side, though I'm surprised that there are some things still in working order in here. Though it seems possible that some portions of the building have become warped. And in classic survival horror tropage, I suppose, most of the doors in here are going to be locked, inoperable, whatever you may have. So, for the most part, I'm just going to be ignoring 90% of these doors and just going where I think we need to go. Though I do enjoy taking in all these extremely lovely medical posters adorning the wall here. I am pretty amazed, though, that for a place that's been abandoned for 4 years, that there's an amazing amount of medical equipment that's seemingly been left behind. Maybe this place was very quickly abandoned due to those illegal practices that were mentioned before. Doesn't look like there's anything too useful at the reception area unless we want some spare syringes, which I think I'm pretty good on for right now. does seem like we have a game update. Should probably check that out since it is holding our lives in its hand. Though, that doesn't seem like a normal update. Say hello to our first real enemy of the game. Now, as our fine fellow here starts to amble towards us, he does seem very slow, but he's still very dangerous. There is one large caveat that has not yet come up in the game, and that's the fact that we don't have a life bar. Every enemy in the game, no matter what, no matter how slow, no matter how pathetic they may seem, will kill us in one hit. And considering the movement in the game, every enemy should be taken as seriously as possible. Every enemy is a massive danger. Along with seemingly the environment in general. The good news is that, for the most part, most enemies aren't too likely to follow us between rooms to room. Which is a good thing, because we don't want to be constantly running around, maybe accidentally falling into big giant holes in the floor. Now we don't have any means to jump, so we're just going to have to take a slight detour. Though we're not going to be able to take a bathroom break, even though it seems like the water is still running. Something about this bathroom just seems kind of off. Just a tiny bit. Also, some rooms in this hospital, I mean, just outside of the nooses here and there, some of the doors, some of the chain-covered beds, this place definitely could hold some illegal activities. I'm not entirely certain what those could be, and I hate to spoil it, we probably will never figure it out. The game enjoys dropping these tantalizing little bits and never really feeling the need to fully explain them. Though I feel like sometimes that does heighten the creepiness of the game. I definitely doubt they would have left babies laying around in here. Probably just our imaginations. Really, in the end, a lot of this could just be our imagination playing tricks on us. We're in a very scary, dilapidated hospital. There's just very weird, horrible stuff in seemingly every room, but yeah, it could just be psychological, just our mind playing tricks on us. Though I honestly don't feel like checking out to see if the instant death will come from that red-dressed figure there. So since that figure was blocking the hall, we're just going to have to do a little bit of backtracking into the incubation room here. Though we don't want to tarry for too long, that figure is a little bit quicker than the other one. Problem is that we don't want to draw too much attention and this TS just won't quit beeping. So that probably was not the best idea. It seems like maybe we didn't break it completely. No? That Doppler effect is yeah. Yet another good use of the sound work in the game, indicating proper direction, leading you where you need to go. But oddly enough, we do find another TS where there wasn't one before. And even more oddly, it seems to be ours. But with another new game update, we find ourselves progress further into the game in a new town, Freya, named after, I think, the Norse god of love. I might be wrong, I'm not overly familiar with Norse mythology. But love does play a central theme in this new town. And I won't go through the effort of talking to every NPC, but if we do talk to a few of them, we will find out that, much like Verona being blessed with magical water, this town is blessed with magical weddings. If you happen to hold your wedding and get married in Freya, your married life will be ultimately perfect, happy, seems like a totally peaceful place. At least you don't have to sacrifice someone to have a happy marriage or something horrible like that. Sadly, not everybody is wanting to talk to me. Some people are just giving me the cold shoulder. I guess they don't want to marry me. But coincidentally enough, it seems that there is a marriage going on right now. Though there is one little hitch in this particular marriage. It seems that the bride's parents weren't totally they were not totally on board with the marriage going on here. But it's Freya. It's probably going to be good no matter what. Nothing can ruin their amazing day. We also find that the bride's name is Tomoka. That could come up later. Seems very specific to name any character in this RPG. We also find the fiancé has the name Akuta. And we get further indication that, you know, even though they didn't get the blessing, I'm sure this wedding is going to go fine. Yep, there are no bad omens here. Recognize this glitchy-looking NPC, who's the one that gave us the flashlight earlier, so there's a good chance it might have another item waiting for us up in this far corner. But by coming up here, it does trigger a scream that we want to investigate first. There is another item waiting on the grave here. Want to make sure not to miss that. Yeah, let's go and check and see what happened, and yeah, pretty easily telegraphed that something untoward was bound to happen. For some reason, Gouda just up and dropped dead. Not really sure if it had something to do with that glitchy figure that we saw, but I think that's the least of the concerns right now. Especially in regards to the bride. Her wedding day has been ruined. But at this point, we can't leave town. There's not really much we can do. If we talk to any of the NPCs in town, they're just going to say, how terrible, what was that scream, things like that. So, if we talk to this nearby person, they too will say that things are terrible, but maybe if we took a rest at the nearby inn, maybe we can clear some things up in the morning. So, I guess with that advice, we really don't have any more direction here, so we might as well take a little rest. The problem is that we are not allowed a good night's rest. For some reason, Tomoka has come into our room and seems to be a bit on the confused side. She seems to be calling us her husband or her fiancé, which, I mean, you can probably confuse that easily, but I'm not really the marrying type. Sadly, Tomoka is not really big on the idea of someone saying no, and she progresses to chase us through town. Now, she can catch up with you, though she is only going to move relative to your movement speed. But if she does catch you, all it does is reset you back at the end. Not too much of a problem. Though the further we progress towards the exit of the town, the more Discord seems to enter into the soundtrack. Still, having escaped from town, we are safely out of the game, though in real life, you can probably hear the breathing outside the door. We still seem to be cornered by that figure in the hallway. The good news is that not only via sound and sight can we determine if there is a figure nearby, the TS is also another useful means of detecting the presence of a ghost. So, you may have noticed earlier, whenever we pulled up the game, it was the bench being distorted. Well, if we do that right now, we will see a similar distortion that fades away. And that distortion is an indication that there is a ghost nearby. For the most part, though, we won't really ever have to use that function, but it's interesting that it is there if we ever want to use it. Still, with the figure now gone, I think we should probably press with a little bit more quickness through this hospital. We've already been given two ghostly figures to deal with and a phantom TS that's now in our ownership. Yet again, and very surprising that another utility works. Kind of. I'm sure that was just a phantom ring. Phones do that all the time. Looks like we're heading into the operating room. Where we finally get another email from Oyama. Now, for some reason, And I don't know why they kind of paint Oyama in a darkly comical tone here. Sadly, we are not able to respond to him to tell him about all the spooky stuff we've been dealing with to possibly support his theories, but he does remind us that we are trying to look for some information about a death, the death similar to Adaka's that was delivered here to this hospital 4 years ago. And I really can't overstate, sometimes this game does really subtle horror. It works really well. Other times, it takes subtlety and it smashes it against the wall until it is a red paste. And that's not so much of an issue, but I think I personally prefer subtle horror over overkill horror, at least in regards to this game. Still, Oyama is very helpful. I almost forgot that we were trying to look for... Well, I thought we were supposed to be looking for the source of the game in here, which I suppose could have been that TS we picked up, but I guess now we're going to try to look for some information about this similar death to Odaka's. I'm sure they must have left some files sitting around somewhere. I mean, they seemingly left a bunch of odds and ends just laying around. But with this new email from Oyama, what I pretty much mentioned before is restated here, and that's the fact that we want to look for this information regarding this similar death, and we just need to forget about finding the source of the game. That needs to be our main focus, to find this Shin Yutani medical chart and just get out of here as quickly as possible. And at this point, I fully support that. Now, it is a bit amazing that those two ghosts that we met before have, I guess, kind of left us alone. They might feel that this environment is a bit imposing, though. I'm not sure if we stumbled into the butcher shop area of the hospital or not. This, I guess it could be like an autopsy room, though I'm not familiar with autopsy areas having huge tubs. Or for that matter, any area of a hospital being so short with grating. I don't even know what this is supposed to be. But in case you had forgotten that there were ghosts in the game, it's at this point that the game wanted to give you a friendly reminder via a jump scare. Though it does bring up a minor bit of a point in that as we progress through the game, you'll start to notice more and more that sometimes the ghosts just want to say hi. They just want to do a little jump scare and not really be any kind of a threat or danger. They just want to be there for you. As we move further and further in, finding what I assume to be burlap sacks filled with corpses, the danger does get a little bit more and more apparent. Especially in this room. Now, it's pretty obvious that our friend laying down is going to stand up, and we should probably just run immediately to the door. But don't do that. That door is locked, and you will be cornered, and you will die. Instead, what you want to do, turn a quick 180, head out the door, and you'll be safe. And that is a lie. Once you head out the door, he will be waiting out there, and if you happen to accidentally run forward, you will die. This is one of a few instances where the game decides to be a bit dickish, but it doesn't do it too often. I will say it was pretty surprising to head to this door and find it locked the first time, because I died. And if anybody is interested in what happens when you die, if you recall that courtyard we saw from Rico's chapter with all the statues, you just end up entering into the center pedestal there. You'll be dead. But we are not dead. We have reached just where we want it to be, which is in the archive room. And you'll notice that there are just bookshelves full of binders and things like that. A couple of them appear white, like maybe we can investigate them, but that is a little bit of a red herring. Because if we try to investigate them, Davy just does not understand them. Instead, there does appear to be a document here on the center table, so that's got to be what we're looking for. But guess what? You'd be wrong. Even though it is a chart, it is not Yutani's chart. But it is a chart nonetheless, so that means we're just going to have to find another thing that looks like this piece of paper, which is pretty close by. And we have struck gold. This is exactly what we were looking for. And it's time to get the hell out of here. Or it would be if we didn't have a game update. So as we continue the game, we find that we have left behind the town of Freya and have entered into that area that Rico was in her previous chapter. Now, most of these statues will say the exact same thing they did before, so we're not going to worry about talking to them. Instead, we are going to talk to, well, what we know to be Odaka's statue here. And much like in the way that I guess it talked to Rico, the statue of Odaka, or what I assume to be what's left of Odaka's personality trapped here in the game, has a bit of a twisted outlook on life. He seems perfectly happy being stuck as a statue for the rest of his days, because he gets to spend that time with Rico, and now Davy cannot get between them. Though, in much as one would expect since we are here, he seems to think that maybe we're still trying to muscle in on his territory, which is beyond ludicrous, but we also want to go ahead and talk to Rico's statue here. Maybe she can give us some help. But as we talk to her more and more, she seems to be in much the similar mind state as Odaka, which is a weird mixture of priorities. She thinks we have come to see her specifically due to some shared affection, and we're not really sure how Davy feels about her. It never really gets covered. But she does really feel like stating a couple things, which is, one, she loves us more than Odaka, and also, two, she blames us. She feels it's our fault that Odaka got mad at her, and that it's her fault, our fault, and she's now trapped in this game forever. That does not make her happy. It is now time to run for your life. As you can probably tell from the kicking, rad, funky bass line that is now playing through the DS, this is a very dire situation. Riko is very fast, she is very aggressive, and we have quite a bit of ways to go before we can get out of the hospital. The good news is we don't have to go all the way back to the entrance. The bad news is, hopefully you remember which way to go. Because if you get turned around for too long, she will very quickly catch up to you. She is much faster than the first guy we saw. She is much faster than the woman in red. And she will follow you from room to room to room. So you need to run. And you need to make sure you never look back.